I don't normally do trailer breakdowns on this channel. Why? Well, because usually it's too much effort to compare my knowledge of a series to the trailer itself, meaning most of my predictions and such are likely to just be mildly educated guesses at best. And that's also the reason I don't usually watch trailer breakdowns. But this game is different. I have beaten Final Fantasy VII literally dozens of times. I know it better than I know any game. So, looking through this trailer, I actually surprised myself with how quickly and frequently I was catching tiny details. So I figured it might be worth making a video where I break down some of these details for you. Some may be obvious to anyone even vaguely familiar with Final Fantasy, FF7, or Square games in general. But a few other things might catch you by surprise, including some of the predictions I have for how things will be changed to better fit the direction this remake seems to be going in. First things first, let's get one quick thing out of the way. Final Fantasy VII Remake is not episodic, it is in multiple parts. It has been stated and then later reaffirmed that these parts will be full-length games. I already have a video discussing this, as well as what sorts of difficulties such a remake might face, which you can find a link to in the description if you're interested. Moving on, I would like to make special mention for how faithful the world and character design here is to the original concept art and designs. When this project was first shown off, I was fully expecting massive redesigns, but I'm continually astonished and relieved at how spot-on everything seems to look. That's not to say there aren't changes, but from a pure design perspective, and coming from someone who is more than familiar with the world of character design, the art on display here is about as spot on as I ever could have hoped. So on to the trailer itself. Assuming this is actual gameplay rather than a mock-up like the previous gameplay trailers, which I believe this is very much real, we can glean a few things from the first bit. Firstly, since both Barret and Cloud have full UIs, it's assumed that you can switch characters at will, rather than having to switch in the menu or at a save point or something. Notice that despite this being the first reactor mission, they have the amount of health you'd expect to have by the time you get to Nibelheim. Despite this, they have very little MP, as per usual. Of note, we have a single, small, empty bar under the MP for each character, and a segmented blue bar under their health. On the other side, there are three buttons, Punisher, Attack, and Command Menu. Command Menu seems to have two similar blue segments under it, implying that they're linked. In the next bit of gameplay, where Cloud is running and then later hanging from the pipe, there's minimal combat UI. Notice that this also means the command menu and health sections are missing the segmented blue bar. They're also missing the bar under the MP section. Therefore, these must be combat related and only combat related. When we get back to combat, we see the player is using Barret. The top combat option now says Backblast instead of Punisher. This implies that these are actually special attacks of some sort, but critically, I don't think they're new limit breaks, as we'll see in a moment. At the end of the clip, Barret does a large shot with lots of wind effects, which hits multiple enemies. This to me looks like something that would use the name Backblast. And since Backblast is flashing, that makes sense. I don't think these abilities are linked to either the blue segmented bar or the golden bar under MP. The segmented bar doesn't deplete here when Backblast seems to be used, and the gold bar isn't full, nor does it deplete. I therefore think these attacks simply cost a turn rather than a resource. Since Backblast is lit up the entire time, even when Barret is using what seems to be normal attacks, one can maybe assume that the game still employs a sort of rudimentary turn order, rather than being entirely action-oriented. Still, there's no ATB gauge, so it might be more prudent to think of them less like turns, and more like actions that can't be cancelled and are put in a buffer to be executed next in line. I think these special attacks might either be equipable abilities that are brand new to the remake, or maybe tied to the weapon you have equipped. In the next clip, Cloud is our party leader again, and he's using the command menu, as evidenced by the fact that the command menu prompt is missing, and the top of this new menu includes the small segmented blue bars. In this menu, we see a Kingdom Hearts-style shortcut system, with potions in one slot and Braver in another. We can also see that you can switch to Barrett and Tifa's command menus on the fly, potentially implying that you can give them commands even when playing as someone else. Now, the fact that he's carrying 9 potions kind of scares me a bit, because it gives the impression that items might still be the primary way to cure in Remake, as they were in Final Fantasy XV. The reason this scares me is because late-game Final Fantasy XV's idea of difficulty was just throwing out high HP, high damage dealing sponges at you. So high-level battle more or less consisted of spamming attacks for 20 minutes while also repeatedly spamming items. Interestingly, Remake doesn't seem to include the depleting maximum health system 15 had, meaning they might have to go lighter on the spongy spammy nonsense. Also, if these blue bars are tied to everything in the shortcut menu, you might not be able to spam healing anyway. So since Cloud uses a downward slash on the enemy, it's only safe to assume he's using Braver here. The blue bar doesn't deplete, but I think that's because we're catching him mid-attack, after the resource has already been consumed. This leaves the question of what the gold bar under the MP is. At first I thought this was a limit gauge, but it's full when Cloud uses Braver and doesn't get consumed. My theory is that this is an idea snatched from Smash 4's version of Cloud. I think this version of Braver we see is a lesser version. Maybe by holding the button when this gold bar is full, you can do a more powerful version of the limit, similar to how having a full limit gauge in Smash powers up Cloud's specials. If we skip to the next gameplay section in the sewers, you'll notice that the attack command is lighting up irregularly, implying that each of these is responding to a player's button press. But the attacks come out slower than the button presses, again implying that the game uses a buffer system of sorts, similar to From Software games. If we look back at when Barrett used Backblast, we can see the same pulses there, but these look measured, maybe implying that certain attacks can be charged. Moving forward, this next clip confuses me. Personally, this attack looks like Barrett's Big Shot limit break. His limit gauge is completely empty, and he's in mid-attack when the clip starts, implying that this is the same sort of situation as the blue segments when Cloud uses Braver. But Barrett isn't in the command menu like Cloud was, and the player is hitting the Backblast button. If we assume everything I've said so far is accurate, what I think is going on here is that the player just exited the command menu after selecting and using the more powerful version of Big Shot. It consumed his limit bar, and the attack begins. Now the player is queuing up a Backblast to start as soon as Big Shot is complete. If you notice, the blue segmented bar is still full. I take this to mean that if you do the more powerful version of a limit, you only consume the gold bar, not the blue bar. This is consistent with the next clip, where Cloud uses cross slash, isn't in the command menu, has full blue bar segment, but has a completely empty gold bar. Also of note is the health in this clip, and the party setup. Since it's Tifa, Cloud, and Barrett, and they have just marginally higher max health than in the previous clips with this party, but much lower max health than in the sewer clip, we can assume that this is still during the second reactor mission. As such, it's interesting that Cloud already has cross slash. If limits are still unlocked over time, like in the original game, which I believe they will be, this supports my idea I presented in my previous video on the remake, that the first game will greatly extend to the Midgar section, to the point that the entire first game might entirely take place in Midgar. This is also supported by the fact that once the first reactor blows up at the end of the trailer, we see Sephiroth show up, which is most certainly not in the original. I obviously don't think this is actually Sephiroth, but it's fair to assume that he might be built up a lot more and a lot earlier this time. Cloud's buzzy, mind freak episode things might manifest as hallucinations in the remake rather than just text. This is also out of order since the explosion happens well after Cloud's episode after they've escaped in the original. I think the remake will see the party hung up by Guard Scorpion's arrival, meaning the bomb goes off while they're still there, but instead of being a massive nuclear-sized explosion, it'll be something they can actually survive. Cloud has his Sephiroth vision, and then Barrett snaps him out of it so that they can escape. Lengthening and changing the Midgar section in these ways also has the potential to give the player more time to grow to like Biggs, Wedge, and Jesse, making their fates all the more impactful. The one other thing I wanted to talk about is what looks to me like a change in how certain non-combat gameplay segments are handled. Obviously, we have stuff like scripted climbing and exploration sections, as seen when Cloud is escaping the first reactor. But we also see the first time Cloud and Aeris meet in this trailer. It looks like they might have stripped out the relationship choices based on how this scene plays out. Aeris just sort of offers the flower to Cloud, and since it's a cutscene, we can only assume that Cloud takes it. This also likely means he gives it to Marlene without your input, because it implies they want to play up the relationship between Aeris and Cloud, while downplaying romantic compatibility between Tifa and Cloud. The thing is, if we're not given any choices here, why would we be given any choices for how to tailor these relationships elsewhere? Personally, I'm fine with them putting a lot more time into the relationship between Cloud and Aeris. I like Tifa more as a character, but the original game wanted Cloud and Aeris to be the true romantic relationship of the story. And for me, that's one of the weakest parts of the original game. Not because their relationship is fleeting and reminiscent of Hollywood romantic comedy structures, where they meet and fall deeply in love in just a few days, but rather because, since keeping Aeris in your party is optional, and you can snub her at nearly every turn when it comes to dialogue choices, it's entirely possible to betray absolutely everything the original is trying to convey their relationship is about. She can be just as much of a pointless tag-along that you spend no time with as Kate Sith in the original game, and yet you're still forced to pretend like Cloud really suffers when she dies. Spending more time in multiple games on this relationship would do wonders for it, as would more or less forcing the player to interface with the relationship as it was originally intended, without any comedic or goofy choices getting in the way. I think this so far looks like an improvement. Still, a small part of me weeps at the thought that some of this player choice might be gone, and the fact that I probably won't be able to go on a date with Barrett. What do you guys think? Did you notice anything I didn't mention? Do you like the direction this seems to be going in? What more do you think they'll show in June at E3? When do you think the first game will release? My money's on it being between November of this year and April of 2020. Anyway, sound off in the comments below, and I'll see you next time.